USA Warrior Stories is a not-for-profit organization designed to record, archive, and share videos of veteran stories to help veterans make a connection with one another and to help us all better understand their sacrifices for our freedoms.
The war started in 1941, and I started delivering newspapers when I was 12 years old. When the war broke out, I remember going to where the people, the workers, were going to the what they called the chain works, the factory where they made chains and hoists and so forth. And extra, extra, President Roosevelt declares war. Japan bombed Pearl Harbor, and you know, the extra papers. When I was 15 years old, I kind of lied about my age and got a job working after school from 4 to 12 in a steel factory. When I was working there, of course, I was working with some of the older fellows that were being drafted and joining the service. Patriotism was very high. I would have liked to join the Navy or the Marines or the Army, but I was too young at 15. So when I turned 16, I finished my sophomore year in high school. My father signed for me to join the Merchant Marines. I took basic training at Sheepshead Bay in New York City. I'm not sure where I took fireman school, but I went to fireman school after basic training, and then I went to the Union Hall in New York City, and I was sent to, I think it was Pier 61 in New York City, to board the Liberty ship. We were trained to use the 20 millimeter guns. We were trained how to use them and how to help the armed guards that were on our ship to protect us. In the first convoy, we left New York, and we were in a convoy, and we were protected by U.S. Navy. I think we had maybe 25, 30 ships in our convoy, and we didn't know we were going to Murmansk until we got out to sea. They didn't tell us where we were going. We didn't know where we were going, and when we got out to sea in the convoy, then we were told we were going to Glasgow, Scotland, and from there we were going into Murmansk to deliver these. We had, like I said, locomotives and coal car on our deck.
It's the top of the world. It is the most expeditious way of feeding embattled Russia from democracy's arsenal. The shortest route. But for the pregnant ships, the grimmest, the harshest, the cruelest.
The Germans had taken over Norway, and they had built bases, army bases and naval bases, and we had to go past Norway to get up to Russia. So we weren't too far from Norway when we had to take this Arctic run up there. So it was more convenient for them to come and cause havoc out in the convoys. When we were attacked, called to general quarters, I went topside, and I thought, well, if anything happened to the armed guard, I would be able to help. I would be able to take their place or whatever. So I went up on deck, and I got on what they called a potato box. I don't know, it was about 4x4x4, and I stood up on top of the potato box. The armed guards were shooting, everything was, you know, they had everything under control, so they didn't really need me. But I was standing there like a stupid jerk, and I saw a torpedo go right behind our ship. Our captain was zigzagging the ship to make a more difficult target. And he was zigzagging his ship. The convoy had separated. When I was up on deck, I looked and I didn't see any ships around. I mean, we were attacked by the planes that were shooting at us, and you know, the submarines were shooting torpedoes. Scary, yeah. When we were in the boiler room and they were dropping these depth charges, it felt like if you had a bucket on your head and somebody hit it with a hammer. I mean, it was terrible. That noise was unbelievable, that with the depth charges went off.
Murmansk, the goal, Journey's End. Through its ice-free harbor pour many thousand tons of Allied supplies.
When we first got there, we had to lay anchor and wait for room to go to the dock. And then, I don't know, maybe a week or two, and then we went and unloaded at the port of Murmansk. It was devastated. The buildings were completely shattered. The roads were nothing but mud, and they had built wooden sidewalks for people to walk on. I think we were only on at the dock for about 3 or 4 or 5 days. We weren't there too long. They got us unloaded. Then we went back and anchored out until it was time to join a convoy. We didn't have any attacks on the convoy. But we had stormed. We had that storm, and it was terrific. The top of the ship or fork was covered with ice. Our ballast was manganese ore in our cargo. It was manganese ore, and when we got in this storm, our cargo shifted to one side, so we were rolling over 45 degrees, and then back and forth, back and forth. I think we lost the convoy because of the storm, and we were only making about 3 knots, if that, during the storm, because we were rolling. Well, a Liberty ship is 410 foot long, approximately. And so in these rough storms, they were really taking a beating. And people don't realize it. People don't realize that the merchant marines had that much effect on the war. If it wasn't for the merchant marines, the servicemen and the allies wouldn't have been able to win the war because they wouldn't have had the supplies. After we got back to Portland, I was released from the ship. By that time, I had turned 17. I got out of the merchant marines in January sometime. And I think I joined the Navy in May or June after that. When I joined the Navy, I went to a boot camp, and it was called Sampson Naval Naval Training Center. Because I had had the service in the Merchant Marines, they made me a platoon leader. And I had fellows that were 20, 21, and I was 17. I was a platoon leader, and I had to take them through the courses, you know. From boot camp, I went to Newport, Rhode Island, and I was training to be a gunner's mate. And while we were there, we were told we were going to be boarding a brand new ship, which was Oregon City, this heavy cruiser. Because of the regular sailors being discharged that had been in the Navy for 2, 3, 4 years, they were getting discharged. So on our ship, we didn't have any senior gunner's mates. So they made me a gunner's mate in charge of a quad 40 millimeter gun mount. After I came back out of the Navy, I start dating my sweetheart again, of course, Jean. After a while, she agreed to marry me. So we got married in February 1st, 1947. So we've been married for 74 years. 74 years she put up with me.
By decree of the President of the Russian Federation, number 520 of August 21st, 2020, the Medal of Ashikov was awarded to 11 citizens and 6 naval personnel. It was 17, but I'm going to break it down. 11 citizens and 6 naval personnel. Part of the Arctic convoys that transported supplies and military equipment to the Soviet Union during the Great Patriotic War of 41 to 1945. The presentation of the State Awards of Russia Federation is a recognition of personal courage, valor of American veterans. The dedication of the participants of the Arctic Convoy serves as an outstanding example of heroism for future generations. George was part of the American Merchant Marine Veterans, hooked up with the Navy League. We'd like to honor you with the Medal of Oshkosh.
It's a really great honor to be a part of that today. The Navy League and the Merchant Marine veterans got together to put this on, and we're just thrilled to be able to honor them.
I feel so honored to have received that medal. I mean, after 77 years or something like that, I never expected it. I never dreamed that I would be honored that much. If it wasn't for the Merchant Marine American Veterans Association, I don't think we would have been getting any of this recognition. And it's too bad that so many of the Second World War Merchant Marines have already passed away. And it's too bad that this couldn't have been done earlier. I considered a hero like a guy in the Army that was on the front lines, and they were outnumbered 4-1, and here they are fighting and so forth, and they were outnumbered and attacked and maybe saving one of their other buddies from being shot and killed and so forth. And I would call them a hero. But here I am on a ship out in the Arctic Ocean. But then again, you think about it, here's this Tin Lizzie out there in this freezing water, and all it would take is one torpedo to hit the boiler room, and all of us guys in the boiler room would be shattered. Or if we didn't make it up on topside, if we got in the ocean, they say that you would only survive 3 minutes in that frigid water. So I guess that's maybe why they try to call me a hero, but I don't feel like it.